It's the best move I ever made. Started my own company, started doing all small stuff again. And thoroughly enjoyed it. Thoroughly enjoyed it. Gradually worked up then, began doing bigger stuff again. So by the time we've been at it about 10 years, we're now doing £1 million a year turnover, and we're doing a lot of heavy civil engineers because we're very experienced in civil engineering as well as building. So that's kind of my background. And of course, and then we fell into property, to be honest, by just happened. Then I started a property company, PDNSB Properties, and that's done okay. So that's basically my history. And of course, I became national president in 2014, which then finished September this year. Okay? Right, now the next thing is, next slide, please. I'm going to ask you a question now, but nobody will answer it. What's the hardest thing you have to do as a building contractor? Now, don't say find work, and don't say get materials, and don't say getting labour. You can't, I know you won't, nobody ever does. The hardest thing you ever have to do is to get paid for what you do. That's the hardest thing you have to do. We are the only industry that hands out weeks and weeks, sometimes 2 months of credit, no limit on the credit, without getting any guarantees you're going to get paid. This is what we do. As a career, as a trade, as an industry, we don't get jobs, but we do it. We do it all the time. And I do it as well, I've done it. Every mistake I tell you about, I've made. Okay? You'll have made a lot as well, just the same. So, okay, on we go, see, right. Now, what happened was, the first instance was about my contracts. Now, I thought, how am I going to get our guys, FMB members, who most of our FMB members are, I think over 90%, they're very small guys. The salt of the earth, the people that do most of the work, more than actually the big guys, which collectively. I thought, how am I going to get them to professionalise a bit? And start actually getting paid for what they do. Because they don't. I know that, and I've done it, you've all done it, it's the same. So I thought, well, they should use a contract. Now, we can download contracts, I've worked on every contract that's been made, and there's 50 pages of gobbledygook with hitherto, therefores, and notwithstandings in it that nobody can understand. Yet we've got no legalese to understand. So what we can do about this? How can I help our members, our FMB members, to actually work with a document that don't take them hours and hours? I don't know, I've been up at 6 o'clock in the morning, on the side at 7, don't get on while I'm up at 7 at night. You don't want to sat it from the computer then writing, going through 50 pages of contract, do you? You want something that's quick. You're pricing jobs all the time. That's what we do, okay? So I thought, how can I make it easier? So I thought I'd write him a quotation letter. See, most of our guys, they'll put a number. I might be in a bit facetious now, back of a fag pack, and say, I'll do that job for 25,000 quid. And that's what happens. It might be emailed across now. But that's it. There's no detail in it. That's it. 25 grand. So how are you going to get paid for what you do? You know, it might be 25 grand. There's an awful lot more to a building, as you know. A lot of things that you don't know about, you know what I mean. But you're not going to get a penny. You won't. I'll go through that a bit later. So, let me ask you. Now, the quotation letter, I've actually got it here. This is the one I wrote, and it goes, you can actually download it from the FMB free of charge. That's it. One page. And you fill in the bits that's in red there. I'm going to go through them. There's a bit on the back, and that says, basically, accept the price. That's all you need. And that will cover you without any problems at all on 99% of the work you do. And it'll also ensure that you get paid. So first thing, what are we going to do on it? We're going to explain how we got to our price. How did we get your price? How you managed it? First of all, you're going to go in there. The title. Mr. and Mrs. Smith, okay, well. Thank you for inviting me to send it for you. What?
Neil?
No?
Sorry.
Just as a little sidetrack, but while I'm in, if you don't mind me, mind me just saying one thing.
Yeah.
On quotation, one of the things that we've got on our website to actually also help you get paid and make sure that you're making enough money.
Right.
On our website, we've got a facility called Your Jobs.
Yeah.
There's so many price increases coming through in the system at the minute that I don't know how any builder, even us as merchants, struggle to understand how many increases are coming through.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Where your pricing is, when you're doing anything. On our website, we've got a facility called Your Jobs.
Yeah.
What you can do is pull all your materials together,
yeah,
which is going to help you do what you're going to do when you pull all your materials together so that you can get your cost price. You can actually put a margin on it and use it as a document to do a quote.
Yep.
But by saving that onto the system and onto your account, if you then go back to it in 2-3 months,
yep,
it updates to all the new prices. So straight away, when you look at the old one, if it's £1,000 worth of materials, and then you pull your new quote back up, and it's £1,200, you can immediately identify what impact all the increases have had.
Right.
And it's a really useful tool. But again, making sure that you're getting things right on your quote. And
absolutely.
There. So
thank you.
If you don't mind me interrupting,
no, I don't
just
mind
let everybody know about that. It's on our website.
Okay, but explain what we're going to do. So first you're going to put down now is that you're going to say, well, thank you very much, Mr. Crawl, for your work, okay? My price is X number of pounds, okay? And it is priced on, and it includes the work as detailed on the drawing number, okay? What drawing number on it? Dated then, revision whatever. Revision A, revision 1, whatever. I mean, on bigger jobs, I've gone through the alphabet on revision. Because you get a revision on a small job, they've got to change something. Now that can alter the price. It can alter the price up, but it can alter it down. So you need to know. And you need to let them know what your price and your work and have you built it up. Could be engineers' drawings in there. Might be bending schedules. You get them all the time, don't you? They can all change. So you need to say, our buy price includes the work as specified on the drawings, bending schedules or whatever. So therefore, we've got a line to start with now. We know what the price is being built on, okay? Now also, sometimes clever architects will draw things on like cookers and washing machines and all that stuff. They might even draw electrics on. But you also tell them, doesn't include the light bus. Doesn't include the electrics. Doesn't include the heating. Because it's not known at the time of tender. They've drawn something on. You can price it up for them if you want, if they let you know what you want. But at this moment in time, you're pricing for the work, the construction work, actually the building as it stands, based on the drawings that you've actually been given. So that's where that's a good starting line now. So at least we know where we start. The price is always going to be inclusive of VAT, just to say that, okay? And then you're going to, of course, how long is it going to take? 12 weeks? 15 weeks? You know? Okay. You put that in, so many weeks. And of course, what you also need to know, of course, is the lead time, and also the lead time you're going to require. So we can start within 4 weeks of acceptance of quotation. Okay. And also you're going to put on there as well that it's fixed for acceptance for, think about picking up now that the price is ramping up now all the time, you could put 7 days on there. From the date of the quote. Because as Neil said at the back there, you're going up all the time. Or if it's a bit of steady period, you might say 6 months, you know, 2 months, okay? A few years ago, it could be only 6 months because things weren't going up, it was going the wrong way, you know. So that's what you need to know. All that stuff is what you have to do to make sure that you will get paid for what you do.
So you're going to cover later on about how you cover the fact that our order will be down 6 months.
Say again, sorry?
Are you going to cover later on, our order book covers, it goes out maybe 6 months. So we do a quote now, which means, yeah, great, we pay a deposit. And then Howarth's in their joy, being a Yorkshire company, put the price up in January. Quite a lot.
Well, that, of course, has been covered by the fact that it's actually acceptance in so many weeks, isn't it? So your price might, 6 months, you might get an acceptance of your quote 6 months later. Please, carry on with this work. Hang on a minute, no problem there. It was like,
Most of our jobs are we quote me today or get an acceptance next month, and they'll know that we're going to start in July next year. That's what we're at.
Well, that's the risk you're taking then. You're taking that risk if you get an acceptance now and you don't start in a year's time. Then you've got to build in some magical crystal ball stuff in there, haven't you? Really?
Yeah, well, no, we should. Yeah, so that's the question. I mean, that must happen in.
Well, it's happened to me. It's happened to me sometimes when we've been. There's been a shortage of work, okay? So we cut the price and cut the price of that. Anymore. We're not going to work for nothing. Okay, so now we've got quite a bit of work in front of us. Might be 6 months' work. Oh no, look here. The downturn. Works for us. Well, now we're going to bust in our gut with all this work to get it done. No, we're not going to make any money on. And there's pricing jobs now that we could have been doing, that we could make money on. So it's this industry is a risk industry. And that's one of the things I like about it. We never know where we're going to die. But this is it. So in your business where, I mean, I used to do all the work for Nissan in the North East, and I'd work for Honda on heavy foundations, and I get a phone call from a guy, John Duncan, he called me, he works engineer at Nissan. And he's ringing up with Dave, he says, Dave, oh yeah, all right, he says, I want you to do that press foundation, you put a quote in for me, which last, I don't know, year last, whatever, January, I finally got the board to accept it. When can you start? He says, hang on a minute, John, the things have gone up an awful lot since then. Oh, he says, okay, what's extra? I'd work it out, so well, the price has come down, 12.5%. Okay, 12.5% on the top of that, and I get an order, you know. So you have to make it clear that it's only for a certain period. And you have to almost be a bit ruthless if things have gone real. I'm sorry, I can't do it. But of course, in your game, I don't know what... You are... What niche are you in?
Just pure domestic extensions.
So you can get in your order book filled up like that. Right?
Yeah.
Which is terrific. But if you make it clear that it's that 25 in a couple of weeks, and you've got open on the bottom, prices are fluctuating so much, there may be a price.
And it's that bit. I mean, we don't price cheap at all, and we don't price expensive. You know, we're good, and we've got a long lead book. It's almost like, how do you manage that? So maybe you're going to cover it later. So.
As I think I've just said it now, you've got to put a clause in there. What was your name again?
Nigel. We might revise the price in 6 months' time before we start.
You've got to say, look, from the acceptance of the price, you know, in 6 months' time if we start then, there may be a price for you. You've got to cover yourself.
In general on that, David, one of the things that you can normally say, we are in very strange times at the minute,
absolutely.
What you can normally say is that price increases that come through from manufacturers normally do come genuinely between January and March. After that, everybody does try and keep things fixed, but at this moment in time, because everybody's kept things and had deals agreed at fixed sterling.
Yeah, they've kept them down,
Or the put stock in prices have been kept low, and now we're getting all sorts of prices.
That's right.
And it is just a crazy time. So
your Howarth sheet for January, some of them are horrendous. Some of them were 15-20%. It's like, Jesus Christ.
Which is why we've been sending out and say to people, look,
this is
what's coming through, guys. We don't hide it, we tell you these are things that come through.
Yeah. I mean, what you can do, of course, is you can put on there that our quotation, I think, dated then, is based on the current material price as of now.
Yeah.
And you must start flagging it up then, if you want ever, and say, if this happens to go, the material increases that we have to suffer in that time, we must pass on.
Yeah.
It should be all work for nothing, that's what we do, basically. Mm. Right, where am I going now?
Deposits,
interim payments to me, because I might be on the next slide, I think. On the quotation letter, of course, you've got to talk about when you're going to get paid. You don't pay, don't you? Are you going to have interim payments? I'd just say I'll have a monthly. I worked on monthly, net monthly accounting, like I put a good quote. After a month's work, I put the bill in, and I'll get paid in 14 days. You write that in, that's what I want to do. Because you're a bigger company. Smaller company might say, we want paying every 14 days, and we want paying within 7 days. That goes in your letter, that's what you have to work to, really. Okay, deposits. I never took one, but I know they are very useful. And I know that builders like them because they get some money up front to actually start sort of the materials. And I know clients are very wary of them, that the builder's going to leg it, basically, you know. Because our members can actually get an insurance to cover the deposit, so we don't have a problem with that. If you want to join Debt Belt, are you all in them, sir? By the way, you are, yeah? Good lad. Are you in there,
an architectural technician, actually. Okay, I'm just interested to get an overview.
Okay, fine. All right, okay. Nothing against you, all right? You're the one that draws nice washing machines on, aren't you? Yeah, lines like we're electric. In fact, I have a lot of respect for them because these are the guys who are at work. The architect walks about with an umbrella and a pencil and waves his hand. You do the work, don't you? Basically, I do know that. I've got quite a few mates of that. So, of course, we're talking about payments. So, we need to do that. You might be saying, right, it's in there. You're going to write it in. Yeah, every whatever. And, of course, in this letter also, it makes it very clear that it does not include any local authority submission costs, any architectural fees, any engineering costs, or anything. It's all in here, you see. And you make sure that's not in, because sometimes they'll say, well, you haven't included that, haven't you? No, I haven't. But you're telling me you haven't included one. The architect's working for the customer, not for you. The engineer's working for the customer, not for you. Sometimes I get the job, sometimes where the guy will say to me, many times, Can you handle the whole lot? Yeah, of course I can. I can employ private architect guys, I can employ engineers. I don't mind that, but I'm going to charge for it. Okay, so one way or the other, you've got to make it very, very clear. And of course, the bottom one on there, the next one here, this is where we fall down. So where that industry falls down now. Any works requested by the client, local authority building control, changes to the drawings to make additional costs, which, okay, now then, what happens now is, we get cracking on the job, don't we? And we get going, and we start digging, and we're doing all right. Oh, Christ, up here. Where's this drain come from? It should be, it's over there. You know? It's only the wrong place. That's where it's off the...
Oh, there's a man under a flag.
You know. Look at this, isn't it? Can they come? The inspector coming tomorrow. We've got to move it. So you get on, you reroute the drain, you might even put a small man on. But that way, the building inspector comes along and says, "Sir, I'm not happy about that, Dave. It seems all right, but now this section here, I'll be doing another half a metre out. We've got to get it. Just dig it out on me. Ah, that's good. Get down to that one there. Down there, you know. My God, you've got concrete coming at 4 o'clock. I might dig them out and get them cast same day on smaller jobs. You should never leave foundation open. This next thing, following day, we dig some more out. We've all done." So now, what I've done so far, I've shifted a drain, a bit of tree root and dug that out, and I've put an extra metre and a half of concrete in here, like I'm digging the muck out and taking that and tipping the machine down. So straight away, I've incurred a lot of cost. A lot of cost. Now, if you don't do something about that at this time, and write it down, actually also, just to get the FMB flag up again, we actually do a change of work page as well, which we can write it down. Instruction by the area, we have to take it down. That's it. Because when that lady walks around that lovely job that you've all done for her, and you're presented with a final account, and it's another 3 grand. And What's this about? I give you about 50 grand extension. You finally have 10 grand now, 10 grand, yeah. What's this thing? Well, we have to do work, fix the concrete, didn't we? You know, and then we have that tree room. What for you? I had to dig it out because it was. I didn't look at it. Well, we didn't know we had it. And then we've drained it back home, you know. That's frustrating. I can't afford it. I've got 3 grand. I'm up to deal with mortgages. I've borrowed 5 grand off my father in law. I haven't got any more money. I'm sorry, no. You're the master builder. I'm the master builder. You are. And you're the master builder. You should know these things. Well, I've got a crystal ball that was in the ground. Well, no, but you gave me a price for a job. 50 grand, and that paying you 50 grand, you're just lovely job, you're a cracking job. You're really chuffed about it, you really tell everybody what great building you are. But I've got 3 grand. I don't feel anything. It's a risk item for you. You're a builder, you know what you're doing. I'm a clerk in the town hall. I don't know. So what are you going to do then? And then he says, oh, by the way, the 10 grand final account I can let you have is, you can have it on Monday, you know. Monday, you know. That's handy, Monday. Brilliant. And you're thinking to yourself, now then, I've got Howarth coming to pay, they want 4.5 grand, then they'll be after me if I don't pay them. What's he got? And there's very big company, they want me, oh my God. Oh my love, for these friends, what bloody hell. Okay, you're not going to get 3 grand, but you get your 10, and you walk away and you think, well, at least we've got a salesperson who's going to speak volumes of our company and our workmanship and all that. But I've still paid 3 grand for privilege, haven't I? You're not going to get it. You're not going to get it. Simple as that. On the final account, also, this is another one which is really I'm very, very keen on, and you should all know this being builders, is that the final account should only be the mopping up. Now, builders love to have a nice draw end. We'll save some in, we'll just ease off it. We're okay. Have a nice draw end. That's a big mistake. Big mistake. You'll get the money as you're going through. Try and time it so that the interim valuations, and you get the last one, perhaps a couple of 3 weeks before you've finished. You're not having a problem getting it then. Okay? So you get the last 10 grand then. That's lovely. That's what we've got to worry about now. It's a little bit of mopping up. At least 2 or 3 grand of extensions, if you can leave it that way. So now when he starts talking about what he owes you, he only owes us 3 grand, you know. So now what are we going to do? Well, you know, it's wrong, we should have done it, and all this and all that, but whatever. Oh, we'll split it, we'll just rip into the job. If you do it right, and you record all the extra, you know what you're giving away. It's important, otherwise we don't. Right. So, we must record everything. Record everything so you know what you're doing. Let the client know. And when you've got extra work done, it's like the foundations or whatever, and the tin roofs and rent, that cost extra goes in at the first valuation. We've done it. Our evaluation for the works is £10,000 plus £3,000 because of this, that, and other, whatever. And you've let them know this is what's been happening, we've taken going down your cost. £1,500 for the foundation, and of course we have to take that tree root out, we do a day for a couple of blocks, and go to the drain, and that's how it's built up. That's when you'll get it. If you leave it to the end, you won't get it. Or to put this way, you'll be compromised to get a very small amount of it. It's a fact of life. Because we are the only people in the world that do that, the only industry. I mean, if you're having your car in for a service, and the garage ring you up, oh, I'm with you, but, or your van, okay. Front tire or one inside, and outside front, offside is getting there, and the brakes on the line. Do you understand? Okay, we do it and we pay it, don't we? In our industry, we don't. We do it and then worry about it after. Sometimes you can't get it up front, you can't get the agreement because you've got the concrete coming down the road and the inspector's only just gone, you know. And you want to get these foundations covered up. So we compromise. So work on it, record it, get it in there, and get it priced up so the client knows exactly where it is. That's the main thing. Now, what's that? Where are we now? Okay, yeah. Other things you must have here as well. And it's all on quotation, like it tells you everything. So you do it for you. Storage facilities. How many times you all do domestic work or whatever? Storage facilities. You go down there and say, right, we have some storage for you. Well, we've got materials coming, you know. And we've got bricks, we've got rocks, and we've got salmon. We can have this bit, like, you know, whatever, you know. Agree what you can have. Because next thing you're going to turn up, if you don't, there's two cars parked in drive, you can't get in drive. So you can shift hers, he's taking his keys, he's taking the he's got a lift to work, the lift is. Take your keys away because you can't see if it's a damn car. So you stick. What do you do? So you've got to agree first. Agree everything. It's so easy when you're getting the job, as you learn.
Recently on planning applications, we're getting conditions on now, especially from highways, saying before you start work as a condition, you've got to show us where your compound is going to be, how are you going to park your cars off the street, where you're putting all your materials. So they're not having any issue with book on the road, and we have a village near me, there's hell on because there's that many vans down the street, they can't get up the road.
I know,
it is getting quite an issue with storage thing, the condition.
Thank you for that, yeah. It is. So we agree what we're going to do. We agree with it, we've all sat down at the table, you're going to give us the order, and we talk about things like that. Now, the services available. Can we use your electric? Can we use your printer? Oh, yes, no problem at all. I know a builder that had the amount of money deducted off his final account because their electric bill had gone up from X to Y, whatever, over the 3 or 4 months they were there. With that fastidious, this guy knew exactly how every time he switched a light on, you know, and he deducted off final account. Wow. Terrible, it's awful. So, we'll find out, can we use your water?
Toilet's the worst.
And of course, welfare facilities and washing. Now, sometimes you might be working in an outside toilet, but I mean, it's not like, oh, did you maybe use it? I'm sorry, no, you can't, we haven't got one, no. So yeah, I think the storage for you, a portal, I think, 30 quid a week, I think. Yeah, 30 quid a week. So, you know, that's another 15 quid a year, which you've got to build in. So, when you're building your the charges, and they're kind of for the transport and all that stuff. All that has to go on. Yeah. Areas of work. Now, we're going to be working on the front here, you know, so we've got a storage facility here, but we're going to actually need all of this here because we're actually extending out. You want to talk? What about my garden? You know? Oh, we'll look after your garden. We'll make sure we do it all right. Yeah. I mean, some people think you can do a job on time, never go near it. You don't realise, to get an omelette, you've got to break eggs, don't you? You don't think that, some people, honestly. So, value of reclaimed materials, I've got a plan for this one before. Value of reclaimed materials. All materials that we take out on site belong to us. Okay. I was re-roofing. What is it? 16th century or 17th century. Three-story kind of old house in the village. And all the houses around it, they've all changed into pantiles. They looked all right. And they wanted these changing, and we could do it all right. There was stone slates on the front. You know, I thought, these are handy. They're expensive stone slates. I thought, we can take a few of them and get these down and we'll sell them. I don't know when we roofing contracts. So, well, I could get all right there. Yeah, we're all right. We're getting a good price for them, you know. Oh, thank you. So, we thought we'd done all right, you know, we'd get these down. By the time we got them down there, she says, oh, by the way, they're mine. What do you do? Well, we didn't win. No, you know. So, she claimed them then, and then weighed them in. In fact, they're on staff, we had to get them down. Exactly. But this is how people are, you see. So you make the No, it's because we'll meet it. No. Yeah. Alright, yeah, thank you. Value of reclaim. Just let them know, let them know we stand. And where we are now?
Day work.
Day work items. Now, this is usually, you know what day work items, don't you? This of course is work outside the agreed contract works where normal rates can apply. Because when you're doing, extra work, which is all the time, I price up in rates, I'm a contractor as well, don't you know? You price up in one rates, don't you? So you square meter by figures, and numbers up and all that stuff. Within your meter, don't you? So, but if you're doing it by day work, then go on there. Because that's something you've gone back to do. You're working over, you're doing whatever, so you want to actually put in a day work rate. Our day work rate for works outside contract works that can't be priced out. Our rate will be, well, you want to be batching rates, you know what they are, don't you know, the batching rates, carrying on the station, it's about 12 or 13 quid an hour, I think it's quite a bit more. At least 100% you need for day work. Probably 120% more like it. So if you look what it costs, you don't employ anybody for insurance and all that, it's not safe and everything else. I mean, I think we sent down the thing, it was at least 100%. And planting materials, you want between 15 and 20%. It should be on there, and it's easy to fill in. There we're it. No, fill it in. And it's all on the quotation letter. Now in there. So basically, that's the quotation letter. Very simple. Because there's one there. That's mine, which I wrote. I know wrote all. I also wrote the next section, which is the terms of business. Right. Now I've got one somewhere. This is it. Two pages, and big enough writing so people can read it. Okay. All right. There's no hitherto, therefores, and notwithstandings on it. Okay. It's in English that we can all understand because I wrote it. And of course, it covers a lot of other things in here, just which you would answer with that when you fill it in. Oh, that's it. That's what we should have to read that. That fleshes out a little bit and puts a few other things in there which you need. You know, which you need to know. Basically now, one that always crops up, and this has cropped up a lot of my members actually, retention monies. Ooh, don't like that, do I? Do you have to pay retention? No. What happens then, oh gosh, you could have. What happens if somebody says you're in a cracking job, Martin, you know, really job you on trigger, but I wouldn't stop 10% of retention of my account.
It's never happened.
It does that.
No, it
does. No, which is all written in there, and you know, but it's all written in there, Mike. It says, you know, retention money should be 5%, if you like, and then half of it, 2.5% is released on the date of handover. And the other 2.5% is up to 6 months' time for a maintenance period. That's easy indoors, just indoor closes, and pushing paint up, whatever. That's what it's all about. but people are stopping it. But of course, down here we say retention monies are not agreed. No. You have to be quiet, and the only time a retention money can be accepted if it's agreed at the time when you're submitting the tender. Now, if you say, well, okay, I've got retention monies on this job now, okay? So you can include 5% on your price to cover your retention that you're going to submit for the whole of the contract period, okay? Plus the 2.5% at the end. And that can really make a difference between getting a job and not getting it, but you're not going to get it loads of money. So retention monies are a nightmare, and it's happening more and more with our members. I hear about it all.
Is that domestic as well as commercial?
Oh, yes. Oh, yeah. Well, you get some clever people, you see, you know. Clever people that said, you know, and some of the professional trades, and I won't say what they are, professions that are worse than a lot, usually people are very, very clever, I think. Yeah.
Doctors and solicitors.
Sorry?
Doctors and solicitors.
Yeah. Solicitors and teachers.
We get loads of doctors.
You've said them all, actually.
Yeah.
You've said them all. You do that too. Have you got a last drink of water?
Well, okay. Dentists, I missed them.
Sorry? What?
Dentists.
Well, we up. But they will, that's right. And they can be as nice as pie all the way through, and then it all goes wrong. You know. And if they prevent you with a fated company, if you're not covered, what are you doing? You can't do anything, can you? You've got your money. They've got your money. So, also on the terms of, so that's retention, we don't have them at all. We don't want them, but if we have to have them, you know back at the time when you put the tender in. You can't introduce conditions like that after. That is illegal.
That's an unfair term.
Sorry?
That would be an unfair term, introducing it after.
Of course, you can't do it, that's it, so. And of course, on the terms of business, it gives the duty of the contractor, we shall do this and we shall do that, and we shall put all the right materials, all that kind of stuff, you know, which is pretty normal. And of course, it says on there that we can actually charge interest if you're late paying. The percentage of, I forget what it is now, it can be something like 3 or 4% of our base rate, something like that. But you can put that in. Now, not the owner do it, but it just makes people realise that, you know, it's, we're not a philanthropic organisation, are we? No. And we're not here for our benefit for mankind, we're here to make a living for the weekend and pay our guys who work for us. So that's what we're here for. Oh, and also in is the obligatory termination of contract 14 days, which is that, which, in other words, you don't say you buy anything. You buy a kettle, if you like, don't you? You get a contract and you can 14 days to terminate the deal, haven't you? Whatever you buy. But of course, that has to come in as well. But if somebody says, no, I've got to get staff, I can't start for them, they can give you a letter saying, start right now, right? Start right now. That covers you can start. So that's all about. Now, I don't know if anybody asked for it, but you get asked for warranty at all.
It's quite common, isn't it?
You do?
Yeah. A year, whatever we do.
Sure.
Yeah, like a year's maintenance warranty, that's about you mean.
Yeah?
You
get that, yeah?
Yeah. I mean, near for every job, every off that I've done.
You put a quarter warranty on it?
Yeah. Year's maintenance warranty, yeah.
And how do you cover that? Do you cover yourself some insurance, or is it just by your covering it?
Just me, yeah. Just if anything got on them.
On your workmanship, basically?
On my workmanship.
Yeah. That's very good. Very good. Yeah, very commendable. Exactly.
I'd like to do the whole thing on like for a year, but...
Well, no, you're confident in your work. Nothing wrong with that. But, I mean, we can, through the F&B, because our own insurance company, you can get a warranty for 2 years on a £50,000 job for £800. Plus taxes. Now, of course, that stops these things like these go on the TV, like, you know, the rogue traders and what, you know. So it covers that, and sometimes a big selling point, actually. A lot of our members said, because we're not for the warranty now, then it's going down really well. They like it, you know. Because all our members, FME members, if you are a member, they're all being inspected every 3 years now. Some have been a bit slow getting around to them, to be honest, but we'll be getting there eventually.
Yeah. Well, we've been here for 4 years now, our first one's coming up.
Oh, good lad. That's fine.
I'm actually grumpy that I've not been inspected.
Oh, good point.
Yeah.
So that's what we're doing, you know.
Yeah.
Are you an FME member?
I'm not, that's why I'm here.
You are now. You're going to be, aren't you?
Yeah, we'll look into it.
Who's now on your side? We'll try your Federation Master. You're a master, don't you? You sound to me like you're going to give a warranty on it. Do you know what I should give a warranty for? when we were doing domestic work and all sorts, you know. And they said, you know, how much warranty have we got? I said, you get up, probably give me a ring. That's it.
Which is exactly what our warranty is. I mean, we
give me a ring. And I've been rung up, you know, but we've never been called back to a job yet for a problem with the workmanship or anything like that. Sometimes if something's squeaked and twisted or whatever, okay, well, we can reach that door. Might be 2 years later, something like that. But that's how it works. If you're a quality builder and you've got pride in your work and you're comfortable with your work for that, then you think, why not? Yeah. But of course, if people like a piece of paper and they say they've got a warranty for their work life, for anything you do, you get a warranty. I mean, you buy an electric kettle, you get a warranty, don't you? But I mean, in our industry, people pay a lot of money. Just as an aside, another problem you get, of course, is the cash payment. We're getting members now being offered a cash payment on work, something for £120,000. How about that? Hey?
Not by doctors and solicitors, by
Yeah. Honestly, it's frightening.
Yeah, I'll bet.
It's frightening, isn't it? Well, I don't know how they can accept it anyway. How do you get that through your books? What do you do with the materials? You know? But that's what's happening.
Well, how much cash can you put in the bank without them notifying HMRC?
Well, how much?
It's normally a £5,000 transaction.
Anything over five grand.
Yeah. We did someone to can't pay for cash. Yeah, of course you can. Whatever it was, £15,000 plus VAT is £18,000. You got £18,000 in cash, I don't mind.
You've got materials booked out for that job, and you do your accountants, and you do your cost analysis and all that to make sure that we're doing it. But I did say to people in London that, you know, you can't get anything done now under about £1,000 or £2,000 without paying cash. That'll be worth it. That's a fact of life, you know. Anyway. Where am I? Am I digressing again? Where are we now?
Just about Bergen, unforeseen defects.
Oh. Unforeseen defects, okay. What's that one there? right. Unforeseen defects. We've all done it. You and me. You start working on somebody's house, okay? Here we go. Now what we're doing, we're taking this wall out here, we're altering this and doing this and whatever. And when you start off running something, what's happening here? Have you done it on here? Yeah. Should be a Slovenian in the image of a piece of forward tilling. Crikey, that's not bad. So now if you found something unsafe, what do you do? You said, well, I'm afraid, it wants altering, we've got to change it. But honestly, you're going to pay for it. So you've got to charge from unforeseen. I mean, I once did a stone cottage. I have never seen a like it in my life. I mean, we put in a contract price to upgrade this stone cottage and do all sorts of videos, a new roof on it, and these two ladies are spending £100,000 on the place, honestly. This would have been better off being pulled down, even though it was almost, it was a great tool to build, you know. Honestly, the work we found was the stuff we have to make it safe. They must have put the price up by £50,000 just to get it back as a livable, suitable place to live in. Fit for purpose. But that's unforeseen work. So obviously you make sure that you know about it, you tell them about it, and you cost it, Jack. But this is going to cost you. It's got £8. And agree, and at your next interim, don't wait till the end, put it in. Get it, get your money in. Cash is the lifeblood of any contract. What am I doing now?
Asbestos.
Asbestos, of course, obviously. With asbestos, you've got to ignore it. Let the authorities know straight away, walk away and get it sorted out. You can't do anything else with that. Okay. Working hours. Also, you need to include that. People are very, very awkward. You know, your working hours are going to be 5:30 or whatever, Monday to Friday, and so on, so, you know. Or you turn up without getting that organised. We can't start this morning. No, I've got to take my little to school and, you know.
I've had it before, someone started at 10 o'clock in the morning instead of 8 o'clock.
Exactly.
Give me a laugh, mate. Because it used to work nights, you see, so.
Oh, yeah, don't come before 10, I've got to get me sleeping. Oh, great stuff, what are we supposed to do? I'll meet while 10. So the sun's like that. It's ridiculous, isn't it?
Yeah, it's crazy,
but
yeah.
People ask you that.
They do, yeah.
They expect to do that. That you're going to bend over backwards and accommodate them, you know, which you do help them if you can. But some of the stuff you have to do. And also you get the one where, you can't work today, because, what? Why not? Well, I've got to go out and I've got this and I've got that and I'm you know, he's not here and the kids are, what am I supposed to do? You know, I'm twiddling my thumb, who's my parent for today? Me and these four guys are sat in van. What are we doing? Get the hours of work sorted out. It's so easy at this stage. Sort it out, you're to work 8 or 5. Okay, are you 5:30? What have you want to work? So, it's agreed now, and you've got a problem. Other operatives are so on. How many times you don't want to do a job for somebody and he says, so who's doing the electrics? Right? You haven't asked the supplier? No, we're not asking, no, but my wife's uncle has got a son that's, he's an electrician, well, he's not now, he's a bus driver now, but he's an electrician. And he can come and do electrics for me at weekend. Oh yeah, is he? Oh, he's going to do it cheap, so do it for me, I'll pay him direct. Oh, yeah, okay. And he's going to do it at weekend. Yeah. And also, I've got a nephew who's a plumber, but he works full-time for a corporation, but he can come and do plumbing at weekends, you see. Right, so they'll come and do it. Now, if you're daft enough to fall for that, which I'm never happy, if you're daft enough to fall for that, your electrician and your plumber are supposed to come one weekend, haven't you? And you tell them on Monday morning, expecting work to be done, so you can, and you go, we can't come. You're bound once, so, you know, you have to take your missus to the hospital, she's pregnant, you know, she's out. What am I supposed to do? I should have been here. Well, it's going to be all right next weekend. Oh, I want to be doing next week. You know, I would never have anybody working on that side unless they work for me. They work for me, I'll pay them, so you pay me. I don't mind it being him, but it will work to my rules. They'll work when I want him working. We can't come on it weekends. What am I having then? I'm not doing it. You better find somebody else doing the job, because all you're doing is you're going to. You're printing money to lose. What are we going to do? I live next door to me, built house. A piece of land, so I'll manage to get it for him, actually. He's a builder. But he's a stockbroker. He's doing the jobs, and he lets other people come in and do work, you see. What are you doing, Jim? Quite saves him money. Because it's costing you money. He said, oh, it is, David, right. He said, I'm fitting a kitchen for this guy. And he said, nice job. He did a good job, actually. The kitchen for a bloke. Well, this kitchen turns up, he's going to do it, he off he goes to start it. And you have 7 feet for cabinets. So we haven't got it, we're all here ready to go. But we are. Well, can't you do something? What am I supposed to turn the cabinets on? There's no feet. Oh, they're not coming by Thursday. Is it a problem? It's a problem. You know, you have to handle it yourself, it's laughable, isn't it? But we do it. We do it all. We do the whole thing. Because we're daft. We're daft. This isn't daft to me in this case, but we are at all. Okay. Materials. What do we say about materials, Dave? There we go. Yeah. Well, that was about salvage material. That one, that's what that one's about. Right. So, that's gone down most of the stuff I've done there. How are we up for time? Are we all right?
Yeah.
Are
we?
Yep.
How long have we been on? I have no idea. How long have we been talking?
3 minutes.
And 8? Too long.
3 minutes, you've been on.
Thank you. Another thing. Never refuse money. Never refuse money. I know somebody very well who did. Cost him dear. You're lucky at him now. So, good story. Any story I tell you is true. This was a. You'll be familiar with, you might not be actually, the airy houses. Remember the airy houses? You remember them? You remember them?
Yeah.
They're the old. They were built just after the war, I think, yeah? And you'll see them round tucked in villages. There might be two or three pair. They were like a big, you know, housing the, you know, working
class concrete.
And they were concrete panels that were like this. And actually, they stood the test of time. They still look well. But they're a maintenance and an insulation nightmare, and they were the concrete frame with these panels stuck on the outside, and inside the concrete frame was a steel tube, and the steel tubes at the bottom started to rot off, so they've become dangerous. And so there is a scheme where you can actually convert the area house back to a normal dwelling. You're not like this, what,
yeah? Yeah, it was a special foundation system.
That's right, yeah, but you have foundations on, and you build a cavity wall construction insulation, and you change it. You'll see sometimes as you drive about, you'll notice these. And you'll see one that looks like an area, the old concrete panels on. Then you see one that looks like a normal piece of glass. Bricks in, yeah.
An extra 10 town.
You've got it, you've got it. So anyway, so we got the chap to actually convert one of these. The guy who was, we were working for, our surveyor, who I've known for 40 years, it was his wife's uncle. That's how solid they were. And we knew he'd sold a cottage in Derbyshire for £300,000. And he got the money because he's never a mortgage. So he's got £300,000 as well. And he's taken over with this woman who lives in this airy house, and he's going to convert it to a proper insulated, structurally sound dwelling. Okay? And he's doing this because the view which he got from this area was phenomenal. It was a view to die for. He used to build them anyway then, and this was terrific. So we went down there with the surveyor, and my mate, and of course we know he's got this money sat in the bank. So he says, you know, right, yeah, but you're going to do it. My surveyor said, I'm not going to do it. So the guy said, well, look, I forget what that price were. It was getting to us 100,000, it was a lot of money. So he said, I'll tell you what, I'll give you the money now, I'll give you the check for now, and you can put it in your bank and use that. Guess what I said? Go on, guess what I said? No. I said, no. I said, no, it's okay. Do it on monthly valuations, you see. You know, it's sound, we know the guy's got the money in the bank. Monthly valuations. What? And he thought, sounds a pound. We know he's got the cash. Now, of course, when he saw the house we were doing up, he had to move out of, you see. So what he does is they've got dogs. Well, so what he did, he thought, I've got to rent somewhere now for the 6 months or whatever it takes to build this. And they had to get a place that would allow him to take dogs. Fine, isn't it? All right. Okay, all sounds good. So he done some training with a financial guy with a nearby small town, who'd done a good job for him. So, and the rent for this house he was renting, because it had dogs and land, it was £1,000 a month. So it's a hefty rent. Anyway, so that's it. I mean, he's having it. And he said, well, then he thought, if I invest my money, the interest will pay the rent on this property. What a good idea. So he invested the whole of this money with this guy to get this big rate, interest rate, because he said he could get it for him. He invested it in South Africa to get the big interest rate. So we do the first valuation, $25,000, you know, which we expect to get. And the check come at my partner. I said, oh, check's come out for right, lovely. Put in the bank, we came back, prepared to draw, bounce. What's happening here? It's bouncing. I know he's got the money. I got over and said, what's happening here? He said, well, it's bank money, he's been on all the money, whatever, all that stuff. But we know he's got the money. Well, what we thought. So we think he's sound, this guy. So we get next valuation, another $25,000, lovely. I then get a cheque for $50,000, though. Oh, lovely. $50,000, here we go. Back it straight in the bank, boom, going bouncing back again. I thought, this is going on now, $50,000. Now, fortunately, we'd had a cracking year the year before. If we had to do both. So anyway, I said, there's something wrong here. But we're still working on it then, by then. We've now got the shell up, it's all ready. We've plastered out, we're ready for putting the staircase in, you know, the kitchen. We haven't told the kitchen yet and all this. So I said, we've got to stop work here. There's something wrong here. So we stopped work, pulled up, and we boarded it up. And our surveyor's gutted because he can't understand what's happening. Doesn't know anything about this loss of money in South Africa yet. None of us do. We can't understand what's happened. Yours is now more than $50,000 because we've done some more work as well. So anyway, turns out then that, well, early will be our solicitor, so he gets on the ball, fortunately, and he actually managed to get the first charge on this property because there was no mortgage on it. So we got the first charge. So we then had to go through, because it's a big money now, we're going to the Crown Court for this one. Oh, dear me. So we get judgment, and then we get the bailiffs, because what he'd done in the meantime, he'd broke into the house, because in a past life he used to be a joiner. But then he was doing else, but he used to be a joiner. So he cobbled himself a staircase up. There was a water into this house. And he moved in. So he's moved into this part finished house. And he hasn't paid a penny for it to us. So what we know, so they're about to get the bailiffs there. Now if you've seen them on the TV where they can't pay, won't pay, all them with the bailiffs going on. Well, they weren't lying, that I can tell you. But the police had to be there, you know, and I was treated with such contempt. It made me, my partner couldn't go. I had to do it all on my own, he won't go. He didn't go. I was treated with such contempt, and it's our money, my money, money to keep these guys working, these 10 guys I've got working for me, you know. Anyway, the year out, and then we sold the house. He still owes me 25 grand, but that never comes around years ago. But that's what happens when you refuse money. If I'd have got that money, you know, we'd have been okay. So, never refuse money. Another thing, this might affect you, you might put you on project, is if you're working for big companies, which I've got, I should work for big steel firms, big companies, and of course, you can any contract you like, they just took it away. You, the engineer says, yes, it's fine, David, it's lovely, I'm happy with that. He signs it up, and I'm waiting for him.